This clip is going to be all about how to send a high production value, high quality live stream to Microsoft Teams live event. It's going to be a private event, so it's absolutely ideal for a business when it wants to show something just to its own employees. So only the people that you have sent an invite to are going to be able to watch or attend the live event. Hello again, World Wide Web. My name's Carlos and I run a company called Feel Good Footage here in the UK. Now my company is dedicated to creating better video content for my clients. And earlier this month, I was booked onto a really interesting, ultimately successful live stream job, which proved a really good learning experience for me. Now, since I've already done two in-depth video clips about how to use vMix as a great software streaming solution, I decided why not complete the hat trick with another in-depth clip based on another real-world case study I'd been involved in. So here it is. We'll use Microsoft Teams to schedule and organize the live event, generate the invites and the all-important server ingest URL your encoder will stream to. Behind the scenes, the live stream is being hosted by Microsoft Stream, the corporate video sharing service. But everything you need to do as a producer or attendee can be done from within Teams. I think this could be a great solution for certain kinds of corporate live streaming jobs where a company wants to present something like a town hall or a leadership announcement. At the same time, I think it's an option that's overlooked by many people simply because they don't know it really exists. I used vMix as my software encoder and vision mixer for this job. If you've watched my previous clips, you know I think vMix is a superb product. I've just finished the 60-day free trial. And now I've just paid for vMix HD, which I think is a bargain. I've absolutely no relationship with vMix. I'm just a happy customer spreading the word. My case study then is based on using vMix, but I know that OBS will do the job as well because Microsoft lists it as a supported encoder. So if you're using OBS, you should be able to adapt the workflow I describe easily enough. I won't make any apologies for this. When I do one of these clips, I think it's worth doing right. That means doing it in depth and being comprehensive. However, if you want to jump ahead, here's how the rest of the clip is going to be structured, and I put these time codes in the description as well as links. The brief, choosing a platform to stream a private event, a typical Microsoft Teams meeting versus a live event, setting up an external encoder for a live event, integrating vMix, event presentation and PowerPoint, limitations, alternatives and conclusions. My client on this occasion is a medium-sized corporate firm in London, but with regional and international offices. I've done lots of filming with them in the past and know lots of the senior leadership really well, which makes a big difference on these sort of jobs. Each year, the company usually stages a two-day retreat for the London staff, typically somewhere sunny in Europe. Now, this year, of course, that wasn't an option, but they were still really keen to get the London team together in a COVID secure, socially distanced way for the first time in many months and hold some sort of development day for the London team where they would take the chance to announce some important organisational changes. For those able and willing to attend in person, this would take place at the Grosvenor House Hotel on Park Lane, central London. Usually all the delegates would be in one event room, but to maintain social distancing, the attendees would be split into three large event rooms within the hotel. In terms of a live streaming component, the client wanted to start the day with a plenary session of something like 60 minutes. This would take place in one room and would be streamed to attendees in the other two rooms, plus all the virtual attendees across London, the UK, and even overseas. This session would be based on a PowerPoint presentation and include a video clip. Attendees would then break into their room groups with all the virtual attendees joining a virtual room, which was being run by two members of the senior leadership team. Now, this virtual room was actually a Microsoft Teams meeting that was being organized by those two members of the leadership team and was completely separate to the live stream components that I was responsible for. Finally, in the afternoon, the live stream I was responsible for would resume with another plenary session of maybe 60 minutes, this time in a different event room. So during the break between the morning live stream and the afternoon live stream, we'd relocate and move all our equipment. Now, as I've said, this is obviously a private event. So the first question I asked my client, and indeed myself, was where is this going to be streamed to? On previous streaming jobs, they've always gone to a public platform. Basically, you want as many people as possible to watch that stream. However, in this case, the opposite is true. You only want the people you have invited to be able to watch the stream. So things like YouTube, Twitch, Facebook, they're completely inappropriate. So in terms of a private event, what are your live streaming options? Many of the streaming solutions for private events I looked at are designed to allow monetization of video content and are geared towards scalability, allowing companies to host and stream lots of video content, possibly as video on demand, possibly behind a paywall. But that was overkill for the client and this situation. We just needed a solution for a one-time event. My first suggestion was perhaps use Vimeo. The Vimeo Premium plan offers unlimited live streaming, which can be placed behind password protection. Although I've never used it, it seems to receive reasonably good reviews. The cost is a consideration though, £70 per month, paid annually. At this point, the client's IT lead suggested we might consider Microsoft Teams. Now, I was very doubtful at first because, as I understood it then, Microsoft Teams wouldn't allow the sort of high production value live stream the client had said that they wanted. However, I was very pleased to be proved wrong. Now, as you probably know, Teams is part of Microsoft 365, which is really popular in the business world. As a freelancer, though, I hadn't really used Microsoft Teams at all until very, very recently. I got by just fine with Google Calendar, Hangouts, and Zoom. However, my wife, on the other hand, uses Teams every day because her company supplies its employees with a Microsoft 365 license, and Teams is at the very heart of that. A live event is a type of meeting, so it's worth outlining the different types of meetings you can create within Microsoft Teams. Although I'd been invited and participated in some standard Microsoft Teams meetings quite recently, I'd never initiated or scheduled a Microsoft Teams meeting, so I needed to familiarize myself with the process. I'll also mention that a live event can also be created from within Microsoft's Yammer social networking tool or Microsoft Stream as well. But for this case study, we used Teams, which I guess will be most familiar to most viewers. I think people using Teams will no doubt schedule or participate in remote meetings most days, sometimes many times a day during this current pandemic. As a standard Teams user, when you join a standard Teams meeting, you can choose to join via video and audio or just audio. So far, so normal. It's just like Zoom or Google Hangouts, right? But, and this is important, with the correct additional permissions in place, which I'll return to in the next section, a Teams user can also schedule a live event. That can be set as either public or private. Microsoft allows you two different production workflows to produce a live event, which you can think of as basic and advanced. The basic means everything is done within Teams, typically utilizing a laptop webcam and whatever microphone you've connected. The advanced allows for the live event to be produced via an external app or device, in my case, vMix, into which you can feed external cameras, audio, and a host of production assets. And it's that functionality that allows you to deliver a highly produced, high quality experience for attendees. In its guides, Microsoft breaks down the roles for people involved in live events into organizers, producers, presenters, and attendees. These are helpful to understand as you plan your live event, even if two or more of the roles may be played by the same person or people in your situation. This is a list of what's required by the organizer before they can create a live event in Teams. Now, if you're anything like me, some of that doesn't mean much, but unless you work in IT admin, it probably shouldn't, I guess. My point is, you will need to work closely with the people or person responsible for IT within your client's firm. This also explains why you've probably not considered using Microsoft's live event as a streaming platform, even if you use Teams every single day. Because unless you have the permissions enabled, you can't even see it's an option for you. Fortunately for me, as I've said, I've already worked with this company a lot in the past and have gained their trust. And I worked closely in the week running up to the event with the firm's IT lead, who was a great guy, really switched on, a real pleasure to work with. Now, I asked very early on and was very grateful to receive this, a spare company laptop with all the relevant permissions enabled and a temporary profile installed, which would allow me to create a live event for testing and also to have a laptop ready to monitor on the event day itself. And they've been good enough to let me keep hold of it for a little while after the event, just so I can complete this clip. The takeaway is that if you're an external freelancer or contractor, you'll need to factor in time in the run-up to the event to establish communication with the client's IT admin staff and either gain appropriate temporary IT credentials, or perhaps much more likely, ensure you have the client's IT admin working very closely with you during preparation and the live event itself. So during testing and the live event, I had two laptops, the loaned corporate laptop with which we could schedule, start and monitor the live event, and my personal laptop with vMix installed. Let's go through how easy it is to stream from one to the other. We'll begin with scheduling the live event from within the corporate laptop, which was assigned a temporary profile called Away Day. Having launched Teams, from the Calendar tab, use the drop-down option next to New Meeting to reveal the live event option. Remember, this user profile must have all the appropriate permissions enabled first. A standard Microsoft 365 user cannot create a live event. Many of the fields are self-explanatory. Notice on the right, though, the option to invite people to the event group, who will be organizing, producing, and presenting at the live event. This is especially important if you're going to opt for the basic live event, which, if you remember, was going to be run from within Teams, usually using built-in webcams. I'll explain why during the limitations, alternatives, and conclusions section. In my case, I more or less ignored this. The only person invited to the event group for my live event was the client's IT admin lead, who was helping me coordinate everything. So after setting the title, time, and date, I hit next. Now this stage is very important. First, we define who will have permission to watch the event. You'll notice that the option for public distribution is not available under this profile, and that may well be the case with many corporate laptops. That makes sense. A company wants a live event released under their name to be very closely controlled. So from the options, org-wide and people and groups, we chose people and groups. As mentioned, this event was principally for the London office members. So by choosing this option, the invite distribution could be tailored to that group. And of course, beyond the group, it is possible to extend an invitation to specific people or groups anywhere in the world if you wish. Obviously, the client will determine all this and will probably take full control. Now, below this is a critical choice as you answer, how will you produce your live event? Here's where you choose between Teams and an external device. In other words, the basic or advanced workflow. We're going with external device, in other words, our software encoder and vision mixer, vMix. For our event, we were only really interested in attendees being able to watch it live. However, it will be automatically recorded and available to viewers afterwards if needed. You'll notice there's also a caption service built in for later viewing. I can't speak to the accuracy of those captions, but it's worth knowing about. Finally, Q&A is an option to integrate direct audience feedback during the live event. For this, you'll need someone acting as a producer and moderator alongside you who is a company employee, as there will be editorial decisions to make about incoming questions, comments, and how to action them. In our event, we didn't use this functionality. So after making your choices, select schedule. From the next page, a couple of things to note. First, the attendee link can be copied from here. This is what you, or much more likely, the client's IT admin staff will distribute to whomever needs to be invited. This is the only link that should be used and distributed. Now, if this was set up well ahead of time, you can pause. But if it's a test or the event day itself, you need to hit the join button. That will launch the encoder preview, which is going to display what is actually going to be live streamed to your live event attendees. You must press start setup. If you don't, your encoder will not be able to connect and send to the stream. Once it's done, it will confirm it's ready to connect. Now on the right, you'll see the SSL option, which we didn't use. That toggles from RTMP to RTMPS protocol. vMix supports both, but I kept it as RTMP. Below that is the most vital piece of information, the server ingest URL, which is where your encoder will stream to. I simply copied that and emailed it to myself so I could get this URL onto the streaming laptop. So we can move over to the streaming laptop now, which has vMix open. I've got video coming into my vMix production via a connected camera. For this illustration, the laptops are right next to each other and I'm operating both, but there's no reason that has to be the case, of course. The corporate laptop could be controlled by somebody else in the same room or in a completely different location. I'll go to my stream settings cog and select the custom RTMP server from the drop-down list. I'll paste in the server ingest URL I just copied from the corporate laptop. In terms of the stream name or key, that's not important as Microsoft Stream does not require one. So you can fill this in with any non-empty value. I just added XXX. Quality, you'll determine based on your local conditions. Of course, at the earliest stage, you'll have tested the bandwidth available to you at the event location. In this case, I had over 800 megabits per second download and 235 upload, so many, many, many times more than I'd possibly need. In the description, I'll link to the Microsoft recommended encoder settings, but what was somewhat surprising was that they state 720p as a resolution. I chose 1080p for this job and had no problems. They also recommended 29.97 or 30 frames per second, which I assume is a function of being a US company. As we're in the UK, cameras and vMix were set to 25p and everything was fine. And that's pretty much it. I can initiate the stream from vMix now and can see that it's up and running successfully as the stream tab remains red to indicate the live stream connected and is active. Back at the corporate laptop, you'll see after a pause that the encoded content from vMix is coming through and is ready to be released to the live event attendees. Notice this pre-live alert, which tells you that although you can monitor the incoming feed, nothing is going to the live event yet. You must press Start Event to enable that. I really like the way this is set up. On the event day, you can start the stream an hour or more before the published live event start time. You can carry on testing, rehearsing, fine-tuning with the presenters, and use this encoder preview to gauge how the attendees will experience it. Just remember to start event when the time comes. If you don't, you'll eventually see a prompt reminding you the scheduled start time has passed and you've not gone live yet. The live event will continue until you press the end event button, regardless of what the scheduled end time was. And the server ingest URL will remain valid until the end event option is activated. So that means you can actually stop streaming from vMix, close down the laptop in fact, relaunch vMix, and then resume streaming to the same server ingest URL. Obviously, there's no live event content to watch during this downtime, but this is instead for a use case where you have, just as I had on my recent job, perhaps a day-long event with a big gap between the segments of the day you actually want to deliver via live stream, and possibly need to relocate to stream from somewhere else. The big advantage for organizers and attendees is that you only need to circulate one link for the live event, and attendees can just dip in and out as required when there's live stream content to view. Just remember, once you end the live event within Teams, the server ingest URL is immediately obsolete. If you end the event by mistake, you need to create a completely new live event, distribute the new attendee link, and set your encoder to stream to the fresh server ingest URL that's been created. It's also worth remembering that there is something like a 12-second delay, from my experience, between sending from vMix to that content appearing in the live event. I think that's broadly comparable to the latency I've experienced when I've streamed to Facebook Live or Twitch. That latency is not a consideration for anyone viewing remotely. In our case, the attendees at the hotel who were in the other two rooms, plus the virtual attendees. But it is worth bearing in mind as you consider the logistics for the event itself. So let's assume the stream is up and running. In my case, I had three cameras. Two were fixed and unmanned with a freelance camera operator on a third camera offering roving close-ups. I had radio mics going into two of the cameras and all were fed into my Blackmagic A10 Mini via HDMI. That would take care of the video and audio of the presenters going to the stream, but you still need to consider how you'll integrate with the on-site audio-visual setup. Specifically, let's talk about PowerPoint, which for anyone who has ever had anything to do with a presentation, especially in the business world, well, they'll probably agree that is the core application. So the presenters were talking through a series of slides, a PowerPoint presentation or deck. There would be two sets of people viewing these slides, the audience physically in the room and the virtual attendees watching the stream I was sending to the Teams live event. How do you integrate that? I'll give you three possible solutions. The first two, assuming you have the PowerPoint deck on your streaming laptop. The third, if the deck is remote. No one solution is perfect, so see which one's best for you. In OBS, from what I've seen, the way most people suggest you stream a PowerPoint presentation is to use the window capture method. First, with the deck complete, within PowerPoint, go to the slideshow tab and the setup slideshow options. Here, the show type must be set to browsed by individual window. You can then start the slideshow. Within OBS, add window capture as a source, specifying PowerPoint as the window. Resize as required. I've left it full screen to maximize the detail visible on the slides, but you can make it smaller and add the presenter's camera on top, of course. When that's set, from within PowerPoint, skip back to the first slide, ready to be streamed. Slides must be advanced from within PowerPoint. In vMix, you can do something very similar by adding desktop capture as an input and choosing PowerPoint, which you've opened beforehand. I think this method is okay, especially if you're doing, say, a YouTube video tutorial and want to talk through a deck in the comfort of your home or studio. Personally, I'm not a fan of doing it during a paid live stream because I pretty much want to keep my streaming laptop dedicated to vMix. I want to monitor everything from there and I don't want to be switching between apps, which you'll have to do to change slides, unless you're just running an automated slideshow. From my experience, presenters don't usually stick their deck on slideshow. They vary the time they address each slide, often skipping forward or back. So you need to be able to change on the fly. Method 2 is available in vMix, but not, I believe, in OBS. You can actually add a PowerPoint presentation as an input directly into vMix. The option's right there under the input list. When you do, the deck is available to you to send as part of your main program output, just like any other input. Plus, you can change slides from right within vMix. I really do like this functionality. However, there are some important caveats to bear in mind. You must have Microsoft Office or 365 installed on the streaming laptop. It doesn't need to be running, but without that software installed, the proprietary file format can't be opened by vMix, which makes sense. Audio and video, which may be embedded within slides, is not supported by vMix. Audio will be mute and video won't play if it's embedded within a slide. Again, I can understand this. If the audio or video is embedded within a slide, it's nested. And so you're kind of asking vMix to reach into a box within a box. At least that's how I visualize it. And that's a bridge too far. Finally, and this could be a deal breaker for some, if a slide is animated, within vMix, it will present in its final stage. There won't be any fade-ons or reveals, for example. All that said, this is the option I went with for the event I'm describing, and I'll detail my workarounds in the next section. So for those previous two methods, it's assumed that you have on your streaming laptop a copy of the final approved presentation deck, and it's you that's going to be driving the slides at the instruction of the presenters. But what if that presentation deck is not on your computer? Well, this is a possible solution to that situation. From within PowerPoint and with the deck finished, the presentation author from the slideshow tab chooses present online. The next selection is very important. Notice this box with the option to enable remote viewers to download the presentation. Tick this box. Then press connect. That will publish the presentation to a temporary URL the link for which the author copies and sends to you or whomever is running the stream. Then, from within vMix, the online presentation URL can be added as an input from the list using the web browser option. It can take a while to load, perhaps 20 seconds or more. Also, within both OBS and vMix, the online presentation failed to load on at least one occasion during my tests, with an error message stating there was a problem. I ended the online presentation within PowerPoint and launched a new one. This loaded successfully, but it underlines the need to prepare this in advance. Anyway, with the online presentation loaded in vMix, you can now actually control the slides using the arrows on the bottom of the window. If you do, you'll be advised you can instead choose to follow the presenter's change of slides. But the power of this situation is you can control the changes from within vMix. What's really useful is that embedded video will play through the online presentation. Also, animations are preserved, which are here being controlled as clicks using the same arrows within the window. The only downside is that fonts that may have been used on the original computer that are not standard have been substituted for the online presentation version. But really, this is a minor issue, for me at least. Remember though, this functionality is only available if the author elects to make the presentation available for remote download. Here, I have left that option unticked. And when it's loaded into vMix as before, this time the arrows are missing at the bottom of the window. From within vMix, you have no control. The slides must be advanced by the author, who will have full control. Unfortunately, in OBS, it seems even with the remote download option enabled, you cannot take control of the slides. You can connect to the online presentation by adding browser as a source. And when connected and loaded, the browser window will present within OBS and you can see the arrows. However, when you try to click on them to advance the slides, the cursor does not interact with the arrows. You simply activate the window within OBS. So it seems within OBS, the only option will be for the author presenter to control the slides, which may be no problem, of course. The online presentation will continue until it is ended by the author at the source, that is to say, within PowerPoint on their computer. Of course, from within vMix or OBS, you can cut away from the deck at any point. But once the online presentation is ended by the author, the URL link to that deck is obsolete. This method has really interested me, even though I've not yet used it in a real-world example. I am going to bear it in mind, though, because I think when used with something like vMix, it has the potential to be really, really useful. So where does that leave us? Well, let's go back to using Teams Live Event as a platform to stream something like a company town hall, on-stage discussion, or leadership announcement. As I said at the beginning, I didn't even conceive that Microsoft Teams could be a possible solution for this. I'm not a Teams user, for one, but even if I was a regular, normal-type Teams user, then I probably wouldn't have the permissions enabled that would allow me to even see that creating a live event was a possibility. Now, though, I think they're a really potentially very, very useful solution for certain types of situations. The huge upside is that Teams Live Event allows you to stream a private function incredibly easily with a good deal of security and control enabled from the outset. If you or your client are part of a business already running Microsoft 365 for its employees, I think nearly everything's set. As a minimum, just one or two accounts need to have the requisite functionality and permissions enabled by IT admin. The option to allow the use of an external encoder is a game changer for me. Instantly, you can bring so much more production value into the live event with great pictures, great audio, bespoke graphics, animations, and standalone video clips. It's all there. The only restrictions are the budget and preparation time. For the attendees, it should all integrate fairly seamlessly. They'll be using Microsoft Teams in all likelihood to participate, and that's of course an app they are using every day already. And because it is integrating into that pre-established Microsoft ecosystem within the business, in all likelihood, then their real-time participation and their feedback and their engagement should be very straightforward. Now, that's really exciting, not only in terms of improving the user experience for the attendees, but also for the client, for the business, to get a sense of engagement immediately during the live event. So that is something that we didn't really focus too heavily on during the event I'm talking about, because it was really a kind of first run for both the client and I for something like this. But the potential is very exciting for the next time that we do it, definitely. So what are the downsides? Well, the first one is kind of obvious. The client needs to be using Microsoft 365 across the business already to have access to Teams live events, and also to have an employee pool that will be the audience. The cost of user licenses at scale is significant, so obviously a company is not, I would guess, going to switch to Microsoft 365 just to start running live events. Next, let's look at a difference between the basic and the advanced workflow, which is to say, running the live event from within Teams using a webcam and built-in microphones perhaps, or what we've been talking about, running the live event using an external encoder like vMix. Yes, the advanced will deliver better looking, better sounding, more ambitious, dynamic, and exciting experiences for the attendees, no question. But there's one big advantage for the basic workflow. That advantage is this. With the basic workflow, it is incredibly easy to bring into the live event a remote presenter who can share the contents of their laptop, as well as their webcam and their microphone. Let's go back to the point when you schedule the live event and invite people to join the event group. Anyone designated as a presenter can connect to the live event via the event producer and be held waiting in the wings, as it were, until it's time to take center stage. Then the producer just brings them into the stream until they've finished. I've not used this, but from the example you're watching, it does seem really straightforward. By contrast, bringing a remote presenter into the live event using an external encoder like vMix is more complicated. To bring the presenter's video and audio into the live event using vMix, I would use vMix Call, which is really awesome, lots of control, really, really powerful. But if the presenter was using their own PowerPoint deck or other assets, you'd need to integrate that separately using one of the methods I've outlined. The remote presenter couldn't share their screen as easily as they could in the basic workflow. As I said, for my live event, my presenters were in the same room as me. They were at the front of the room working from a separate laptop, playing their PowerPoint presentation from that laptop to large monitors connected behind them. For the live event audience, I integrated the PowerPoint deck from within vMix, changing the slides manually, following the changes on the large monitor. A couple of the slides did actually have very short video clips embedded into them, which I only found out about on the morning of the event. Plus, separate to the PowerPoint presentation, I already knew there'd be a much longer standalone video clip that did need to also be played. The workaround for this was simply to have all those clips sent to me in advance so I could bring them into vMix as separate inputs. Then, again taking my cue from the presenter, I simply cut those video clips directly into the program output going to the live event, so the virtual attendees watching saw everything at the right time. Clearly, it's a huge advantage to have a running order to work from, even if that does change along the way. The better way to do this, the way I'll do it next time, would be to send the program output from my vMix streaming laptop to the large monitors in the room via an HDMI cable. That way, both the audience physically in the room plus the live event attendees watching online would be seeing exactly the same thing, the output coming from my vMix laptop. To get around the PowerPoint presentation, I'd probably go to the present online method, which would allow the presenters to take charge of the slide changes from their own laptop and at the same time allow the slides to animate correctly within vMix or OBS if you're using that. And with that, it brings us pretty much to a close. What a mammoth journey of discovery that was for me, but very enjoyable and very productive. I really feel in quite a good place for this sort of thing going forward. Now, if you enjoyed this clip, if you perhaps learned something along the way yourself, well, a like is always hugely appreciated, as are comments and questions. You can stick those down below. And down there in that description, you'll also find plenty of links to the resources which helped me. If you're in the UK and you've been inspired by the idea of running a live stream event for your business, maybe the business that you own or you're just a part of, but maybe you don't have the confidence or even the equipment to do that live stream justice, well, do not hesitate to get in touch. If you're interested in learning more about vMix, especially its awesome vMix call functionality, have a look at the clip that's on screen right now where I detail how we got 6 remote guests into 1 live stream using vMix. If you're interested in video, especially if you're interested in creating better content, then consider subscribing to this channel, because that's what this channel is all about. Thanks for watching.